carnival in Brazil, where every caste and creed come together for 4 days of joyous oblivion. This is the showplace of the samba, the familiar image of the black music of Brazil. Like most third world countries, there are vast disproportions of wealth. Cities like Rio de Janeiro are overlooked by favelas, huge shanty towns of manual workers or the unemployed and their families. The population of these favelas is either black or of mixed blood. The wealthier white community lives elsewhere. But it's here that the black Brazilian music has flourished. The favelas are the home of the Brazilian samba. Many musicians still live and compose where they were born, like Leci Brandão. Leci's song describes how black culture has been absorbed by the more powerful, wealthy white community. The symbol of her song is the local samba school. Each favela has its own musical center where black families have traditionally got together to prepare for the annual carnival. But her song says that today, even here, the blacks are just the workers.
The most important characteristic of my lyrics is my life. The words of all my songs reflect my daily life, my loves, my emotions, my friends, my problems. I try and picture everything I feel in my lyrics. I always try to be myself and act naturally. When I went to agents with my music, I'd say, look, if you don't like my work, that's okay with me. If you like it, fine. If you don't, there's nothing doing. I don't need you. And that's how I've been all my life. For me, there's no great problem, except in the case of my samba school, where there was prejudice against my being a woman. So much so that I always lost the samba competitions, so I just got up and left.
The Mangueira school is Rio's oldest, but its black music traditions have been eroded and replaced by big business. Music is their front. But some samba schools are well known as mafia-style organizations financed by drugs and illegal gambling. The samba school bosses have had a powerful ally in the government, which sees the schools with the 4 days of carnival as a necessary and useful release of people's frustrations and poverty. But most favela people want to resist the erosion of the traditional culture.
It's the dominating class, for example, that comes and invades the samba school, which used to belong only to the black people. It was a black cultural place. But the dominating white class came and took it over. So today we make a distinction between those samba people who've sold out and simply do what they're told, and those who still actively write and sing the sambas. You see, blacks are a race of people who love to make music, but at the same time it's not a happy race. They don't just appreciate music, they love it. But then another class comes and takes over the samba schools, and the government supports them. So what can we do?
Carnival and its preparations have become a means of channeling Brazilian energies into a politically harmless and forgetful activity. Are spent in the design of costumes and rehearsing new samba formations. Samba school evenings are still the main musical and cultural focus of the black shantytown dwellers.
The society of the favela continues to be one of the most important areas of black culture in Brazil. It's the center of black resistance to all forms of oppression we face elsewhere in the city, down there in the concrete jungle. The shantytown is still called a quilombo, because back in 1697 in Brazil, there was an African state called Quilombo, a nucleus of resistance by black African slaves. But the history books today tell that it was peopled only by black layabouts, and so our educated, dominating middle class, which is predominantly white in Brazil, continues even today to believe that the favela is where all the black layabouts are congregated. So the deprived people of the shantytowns can't participate in the decisions of the middle class. We are discriminated against.
Das decisões de uma classe média. Portanto, somos marginalizados dessas decisões. Agora, é núcleo.
But the favela is a most important center of cultural resistance in terms of music and religion as well. The two most important things we have as weapons of resistance.
De uma cultura dominante.
The principal religion of the black favelas is Umbanda, or Macumba, as it's often called. It's a blend of African religion, Christianity and spiritualism. A mixture of the many cultures and faiths found in the big cities of Brazil.
Foi numa tarde, foi
samba rhythm, the worshippers call on the ancestral spirits for a bit of help or guidance. The spirits enter then when they achieve a state of trance. Participants fall in and out of trance repeatedly, but they see their religion not as an escape, but as a positive affirmation of the black Brazilian culture. But to earn their living, the shantytown dwellers must descend to the city streets to work for Brazil's European-based middle and upper classes. Leci Brandão performs in a real meat restaurant. Her song contrasts the rich ladies who have everything and enjoy their evenings out with their black servants who work in the pantry, earning next to nothing.
I try to point out to people in my songs the differences between social classes here. For example, the inequality. That's the real problem. Too many people are interested in taking culture only to a certain privileged class. In Rio, all the theaters are located in the south part of the town, which is the rich part. But I think culture should go everywhere, to shanty towns and suburbs as well, because anyone can understand culture. Anyone can understand art. It's just that some people have the opportunity of doing so, and others don't. So one must try to make music not for financial profit, but to make one's work accessible. That's what I've been trying to do up till now. I have never been rich. I don't own anything. I only have what's necessary because before I think of earning money, my first thought is to take my music everywhere and to everybody.
Many of Brazil's middle classes work for the huge government bureaucracy. Manual workers, mostly black, only make about £10 a week in a country which suffers an annual inflation rate of almost 100%. So class differences are great. Since the revolution of 1964, Brazil has been governed by a military dictatorship which imposed severe censorship on all walks of life. Free expression in music and the arts was stifled, and those who would not toe the line were exiled or silenced. In the last few years, the censorship has eased, as both workers and artists struggled for their rights. But the military dictatorship remains firmly in control of all areas of Brazilian life. And for most blacks, that means things stay as they always were. For real citizens, whatever the color or class, the two great escapes remain the beaches and their music. At weekends, sambas are danced everywhere, with an abandon fueled by the prospect of another Monday morning in Rio. Although more sophisticated than the street samba, the modern pop sounds of Rio's new studios sell in increasing quantities. Elsewhere in the world, record sales may be falling, but not in Brazil. New overnight superstar Melodia is being patiently rehearsed for his latest overnight hit. It's been heavily diluted by international pop, and his lyrics mean nothing at all.
Ao som da marada, do tambor do bambu, eu vou pra ilha de Cuba, eu vou pra ilha de Cuba. Ao som da marada, do tambor do bambu, eu vou pra ilha de Cuba, eu vou pra ilha de Cuba.
Live on stage, Melodia performs with highly paid film star Zezé Mota. Since the recent easing of censorship in Brazil, the most accessible forms of cultural liberation are these Western-style acts and the introduction of soft pornography and topless beaches. The song is called Negro Gato and pretends to describe the black cat revolutionary movement of the shanty town from which Melodia comes. But it ends up as a drug-induced hymn to a form of entertainment that has little or no connection with the traditional black culture of Brazil.
Gato, 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 gato.
favela from which Melodia comes is, like all the Rio slums, home of a very different and proud national culture. Brazil is a country larger than the whole of the United States of America. And in these city slums live migrants who came in search of work. They brought with them their cultural birthright from villages far away in the north and east. It's in such villages as Sobara on the northeast coast that the earliest true forms of Brazilian music are preserved. Samba de roda is an African dance brought to Brazil by the black slaves. It's the origins of the samba, yet still reflects the Bantu dance of the African homeland. It's unusual to find it spontaneously performed in today's Brazil. Samba de roda is a communal dance in a circle. Each villager improvises in his or her turn, accompanied by any instruments that come to hand. Among black Brazilians, African traditions are still strong. The African goddess of the sea, called Iemanjá, is especially important. Once a year at dawn, offerings are made to the goddess. Not just blacks, but Brazilians of all races believe the gods of the African slaves have the power to determine human fate. If their offerings are swept out to sea, it means they are accepted by Iemanjá. But if the tide sweeps them back, the goddess will bring ill fortune to the family of that unlucky person. All sorts of expensive gifts are offered to Iemanjá that many can ill afford, from dolls to perfume to champagne. In the belief that the goddess will grant the good fortune, many people won't come by any other way.
comigo, alegria que ela leva. Minha mãe disse que eu não era animada. Doença, tudo comigo, alegria que ela leva. Minha mãe disse que eu não era animada. Doença, tudo comigo, alegria que ela leva.
Cabeira larga, solta os cabelos, jamais ninguém cai a nada. Olha o peixe na beira d'água. Solta os cabelos,
minha mãe já é rainha do mar. Emanjá é rainha do céu, Emanjá é rainha do mar, Emanjá é rainha da terra, Emanjá é a mãe do Oxalá. Emanjá é rainha do céu, Emanjá é rainha do mar, Emanjá é rainha da terra. Emanjá.
The mother of a family has been possessed by Emanjá's spirit. She has thrown herself into the sea in France to receive the gifts of her family. In trance, her voice and manner change into those of the playful Iemanjá. Boats laden with flowers serenade the goddess for a prosperous year. To increase the odds, they take their offerings so far out to sea that they can't possibly be washed back. Years ago, during the festival, desperate people would throw their children into the sea as offerings. Today, it's flowers. But the most powerful and private links with the African past are in the religion of Candomblé. It's surrounded by strict imagery and ritual in places called terreiros. Candomblé worshippers come from all strata of society. The workers at Bahia's International Airport are themselves among the faithful of the Candomblé religion. Candomblé still binds the black communities together, as it did generations ago in Africa. This Nigerian sect survived four centuries of Portuguese colonialism and slavery, secretly preserving their Candomblé by absorbing Christian imagery into their worship of African pagan gods. The worshippers greet their priest, who still chants in the Yoruba language of Nigeria. Candomblé is quite unlike the Macumba of Rio de Janeiro. It retains the strict paternal role of the priest, precise ritual, secrecy, and a communal discipline now lost to Macumba. A unique ceremony celebrates the initiation and possession of a young girl by her god. The god's name is Oshalufu, husband of the sea goddess Iemanjá. The ancient drumming rhythms hypnotize and transport the worshippers. A second girl, recently possessed by her god and still with shaved head, dances for the god Oshalufu to ease her sister's acceptance by him. Offerings are made to please the god and to ease his possession of the girl's spirit. The Candomblé community has in many ways replaced the black family unit, which was broken first by slavery and more recently by migration to the southern cities like Rio. Its power over the community is still strong. These drumming and dance rhythms are the basis of all black Brazilian music.
The black person's culture is an improvised culture. It's passed from father to son. In just that way, Candomblé teachings are passed on through words and rhythms. There is nothing written down. In Candomblé, we use the term made in the mind.
Make the mind.
It's a verbal tradition. It's a society governed by a folklore. So in reality, there are two sorts of Brazil. One that belongs to Europe and the USA, which we call the blue-eyed Brazil, and another sort that still belongs to the greatest black population outside the African continent.
African culture has often been preserved through disguise. During their years of slavery under the Portuguese, blacks were not allowed to arm themselves or fight for fear of insurrection. So they trained themselves to fight in the form of a dance, accompanied by song and the African birimbau instrument.
Eu nasci naquela terra eu me criei. O que tem hospitaleira, nessa terra eu morrerei. Minha mãe tá me chamando.
Capoeira is a form of fighting or martial art disguised as dance.
Yeah!
capoeira kept slaves fit and ready to fight for their freedom. And it's still practiced by many blacks today. The source of most black culture is the city of Salvador in Bahia, former colonial capital, to which slaves were shipped by the Portuguese. Most black musicians come from here, like wealthy pop star Gilberto Gil and drummer Djalma Correa. Their song is about the pretty Bahian girls, who all too easily lose their traditional values.
Toda menina baiana tem um santo que Deus dá. Toda menina baiana tem encantos que Deus dá. Toda menina baiana tem um jeito que Deus dá. Toda menina baiana tem defeitos também que Deus dá. Que Deus deu, que Deus dá. Que Deus entendeu de dar a primazia pro bem pra uma primeira mão na Bahia. Primeira missa, primeiro índio abatido também.
First impression and sound impression is of an old, very Brazilian, very, very Baiano folk song. That's because I'm intending to sort of get back to my original feelings, you know, and my cultural environment here in Bahia. The words, I mean, they talk about girls in Bahia now and living at the same time the traditional values and the new values of modern, you know, society, the supermarket and the terreiros, the candomblé terreiros, both things together. That song, it's really one of those. So I'm trying to give the new generations an idea, you know, of what it's been on since the Africans came here, and also it's very Afro. It's an Afro song.
Though Gil is once again a successful pop star, he suffered greatly under Brazil's recent military dictatorship. He was imprisoned for his unconventional lifestyle and lyrics.
That time coincided with Brazilian changes, I mean political changes. That was 67, 68, when we had the beginning of the dictatorial times in Brazil, and that was a little disturbing and a little dangerous for the control, you know, side, from the control point of view. And so we got some, you know, into some trouble with that was when I had to go to London, you know. I had to leave the country. That was why I had to leave Brazil and stay in England for a while, you know. But then in 72 things started to smooth again, to be cooled down again. Then I came back, and I can say that I am relatively, you know, free to do whatever I want to do, you know.
The wealth of musical culture that Gil draws on can be found anywhere on the streets of Bahia. Musicians don't just play for money, but to accompany the daily rhythm of Bahian life. Bahia is known as the home of black Brazilian music.
Come on.
mythical stories and morality tales are still sung in the central square by wandering musicians from the north.
Diplomado em matéria de sofrer.
A Brazilian blues about the fate of Bahian blacks is sung by Batatinha.
Ninguém vê, sou diplomado em matéria de sofrer.
Nobody sees my despair. They see false happiness and smiles. Somebody must be responsible for all my suffering.
Sou diplomado em matéria de sofrer. Falsa alegria, sorriso de fingimento. Alguém tem culpa deste meu padecimento. Sofrimento de padecer, todos lamentam, mas só eu sei responder.
To make money, Batatinha takes his songs to eating places and bars in Bahia, as is traditional. But his song in his public place is ironically different. Smiling at the world, I'm a very happy man. I have no problems at all.
Sou eu, o grande rei. Imperador eu sou e serei. Sou eu, o grande rei. Imperador eu sou e serei. Imperador eu sou e serei. Imperador eu sou e serei.
Another local entertainer, Riachão, sings an early form of samba about the pleasures of an easy life.
A baiana me deu fubá, vou fazer mingau. Que fufu a baiana me deu fubá, que coisa gostosa é. A baiana me deu fubá, vou fazer mingau de fufu. A baiana me deu fubá, que coisa gostosa é.
It's the sort of samba the black migrants from the north carried with them to the big cities further south, like Rio. Cities where traditional values and occupations change, where the problems of the old world end and the new begin. Where races meet in a haze of industrial pollution. The two top stars of Brazilian music, Milton Nascimento, who is black, and Chico Buarque, who is white. Despite their huge commercial success, both remain committed artists, acutely concerned with the problems and hopes of their society.
Afagar a terra, conhecer os desejos da terra, se o da terra propicia a estação e fecunda o chão.
Milton's song is about the fertile land of Brazil and the natural cycle of its earth. A song in praise of everything that the city of Rio, in which they sing, is not.
My music is aimed at all sections of society. Of course, I would like it to reach and be meaningful to many more people, especially those who suffer discrimination. But here in Brazil, those people are deprived even of our music. It's very difficult, almost impossible, for the underprivileged to have access to our music. It's a luxury still to the vast majority of the Brazilian people. In this respect, the popular artist has a most important role to play. Sometimes almost too important, because he is forced to substitute for the many voices that have been silenced in Brazil. And that happened very often till recently.
Like many other singers in Brazil, Chico Buarque has been imprisoned in the past for the lyrics of his songs.
It is true, the censorship that's so damaging to music and to all other areas of culture has lessened now. But as the law stands, it can come back at any moment. The laws and people that allowed our music to be strangled for the last 10 years are still around, waiting to come back anytime.
In the meantime, Carnival continues to give the Brazilian people their safety valve, their release from the problems of today and tomorrow.
Detalhe interessante do antigo carnaval.